Hi everyone, aloha. Thank you for being here this evening. My name is Georgia Skinner and I head up the Creative Industries Division for the state of Hawaii. And it's our distinct pleasure to have invested in Creative Lab and invested in all the people that are here tonight, as well as those that are a part of the Creative Lab Writers Accelerator this year. This is a very important program to us, and tonight's keynotes are no different. We are fortunate to have some stellar people with us, and on behalf of the Hawaii International Film Festival, Robert Lambeth and his whole team, we welcome you. They are at another venue tonight for their awards, and of course, some of our other friends are probably still voting. But I wanted to say, first and foremost, that we really appreciate you all investing time and being here, because we bring to you people that have transformed their own lives and done amazing things, and we are very glad to share that with you tonight. So I'd like to introduce to you the Executive Director of the Creative Lab and Creative Lab at HIFF, Mr. Michael Palmieri.
Thank you.
Awesome. I'm not done yet. So for those of you that don't know Michael, he is an amazing individual, a humanist, a great teacher, mentor, and also a writer and a producer. He founded the New Media Council along with some other folks at the Producers Guild of America, and it is my pleasure to have him here, and he's going to tell you a little bit about how excited we are to have our guest speaker tonight.
Awesome, thank you. Well, I have my phone. Aloha. All right, let's try it again. Aloha.
Aloha.
Awesome, thank you so much for being here tonight. As Georgia Skinner said, thank you, Georgia. Thank you to the State of Hawaii Creative Industries Division and all your staff for helping us make this happen. So, I'd like to also thank all the volunteers who work on behalf of HIFF and Creative Lab. So if you're a volunteer for both HIFF and Creative Lab, would you please stand so we can acknowledge you? Yes, you can, yes, stand. Kent. I also want to request the current participants of Creative Lab's Writers Accelerator 2014 stand so they can be acknowledged. Please stand. You're the participant. And now I'd like to introduce our keynote speaker. Well, it's more like conversation, so she and I are going to sit down and have a conversation and have you guys partake with a Q&A session after. Lucy Alibar's work has been published in Zoetrope, the Oxford American, and the Wall Street Journal. Her work has also been seen at the National Theater Studio, Joe's Pub, Ojai, Berkeley Rep, Ground Floor, Williamstown, Here, Est, Dixon Place, New George's Avignon Festival, Women's Center Stage, and Cherry Lane. Her first movie, Beasts of the Southern Wild, an adaptation with Ben Zeitlin of her stage play, Juicy and Delicious, received the Sundance Grand Jury Prize and the Cannes Film Festival Cam d'Or. For her work on Beasts, she was nominated for the Scripter, BAFTA, and Academy Award, winner of the Ray Bradbury Nebula Award, the Humanitas Prize, and the Nantucket Film Festival New Voices in Screenwriting Award. She's a Sundance Screenwriting Fellow, two-time finalist for the Heidman Award at ATL, and finalist of the O'Neill Playwrights Conference. She's a member of the Obie Award-winning Youngblood and co-founder of the New Georges Writers Director Lab. Please help me welcome Lucy Alibar.
Okay. Yay! Oh, flowers. Wow.
Make sure it doesn't come. Come here. Oh. Take a turn to the sponsor.
Let's have a seat. This is so nice. Thank you, guys.
So if you have a phone, please turn it to vibrate or turn it off.
I have a horrible feeling that was mine.
Yours?
I have a horrible I'm so sorry.
It's okay.
It's my dad. He's worried about me. He's like, don't get on boats with anyone. Don't trust anyone.
So speaking about your family.
Oh, God.
Well, first and foremost, thank you so much. You've been such a great just participant in the program. And, you know, today Lucy spent lunch with the participants of Creative Lab's Writers Accelerator. And I'd like to start with just how did you first get into writing? Tell us a little bit about your background.
Oh, I, I was really fortunate to live near a really, in spite of how rural our area was, to live near a really good public library. And both of my parents worked, and so I would get dropped off since I was maybe 6 or 7 there. And so I started reading and then just starting to write my own stories from there, because I liked the stories so much that I wanted to. It just felt very natural and fun for me. I mean, they were bad, but I had a great time. it was about Proti the Protoceratops, who's a dinosaur, and like none of the other dinosaurs would be friends with her.
Okay. Okay.
So, and how did that just inform, you know, the experience of the library, that being able to steeped in stories and your passion for reading and writing, how did that eventually translate to your first job or your first published work?
That's another thing. It's Michael and I have talked a lot about public resources for young people and how important and vital that is. I mean, that's another answer that was a public resource. It was, I went to this very good public high school that I wasn't zoned for, so my parents had to lie about the high school so I could go there, and they ended up knowing about a playwriting contest in New York that I wanted the extra credit for, so I wrote a play for it, and then I ended up winning, and they flew me to New York, and I got to do all these things at no cost to myself, and really experience, like go see theater for the first time, which I'd never done, and also meet real playwrights and see how you can make a life as a writer. So it was another, again, like it was very fortuitous and very fortunate, but it was also the result of these public arts programs.
Mm-hmm. And I know that one of the things we talked about was just the role that, you know, city, county, state money played in really supporting your career, because your family wasn't steeped in the arts or anything like that.
Yeah.
And you were sort of, you didn't know where to go, but that through these programs and also teachers,
yeah,
who kind of saw talent in you, sort of nudged you along.
Yeah, again, it was our area. I mean, one of the things I'm so interested in Hawaii and being here and talking to the other participants is our area is, I think, very rich in literature. It just happens to be oral literature, storytelling, like Bible stories, which are crazy and, you know, really wild. And so I was really fortunate to have not necessarily writing teachers as much as people who would just tell me that they liked my stories and to try and make it a little cleaner or funnier instead of just telling me to shut up. You know, but I guess, I don't know, I think the theme that we keep coming back to, like when Michael and I talk and then when I've been here, is just how important that, how much of a difference you can make if you just encourage somebody's voice and in a disciplined and thoughtful and mindful way.
And I know you sought to give back from a very young age through programs that you've started and or participated in, so tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, I think the most... The thing that I did that I feel the most proud of is this writer-director lab for young female, young or early career female playwrights and directors in New York, just because it's, film is really hard, theater is really hard, because you're never going to make any money. So it was, seriously. So I wanted to start, I was interested in... and I think this can carry over to film, and it's not limited to gender, but what I noticed is because there's so much scarcity, it fosters this sense of competition that isn't real. And I wanted to start with young women who are writing and directing to be partners with each other and learn to support each other's work, and that we can all rise together.
That's awesome. So let's go back to your writing. So you started with plays. And so what informed the writing that you expressed into the world? When you look back at the plays that you started with, and you know, from that high school story that you were able to write and that got you into that program in New York, looking back, what informed that writing? What was it about that writing that inspired you, or that, you know, that spark that inspired that writing?
I think it was that I homeschooled for middle school, and I read this book of Ibsen plays, and so I thought that was what plays were, and I loved them, but that was what I thought a play was. That was, you know, that was the limit to my imagination. And then I got dropped off at the library, and I read Indazaki Shange's For Colored Girls Who've Considered Suicide, wow. When the Rainbow's Enough. And I get goosebumps. The honesty of that story, like the last lines where she says, I found God in myself, and I loved her fiercely. That hit me so deeply and so, and that it's a play in verse, and that they're, it's just so different from any other play I ever read. So I think reading that really taught me that stories can look like anything, plays can look like anything, and that you can talk the way that I grew up talking is much closer to that play than an Ibsen play, and that you can speak the way that you speak, and people will understand that, and that'll you can still reach people.
That's awesome. So you, obviously, Beast of the Southern Wall is based on your play. And what was the major distinction between being able to put it on as a play and working and workshopping it and working with Ben to turn that into a movie? What was the process for you like?
It was pretty different. I mean, I think the play I wrote, it was a very visceral reaction to my dad being sick. And I didn't think of it as an end product that I'd show people. I just had to get something down. So it almost felt like a very personal diary entry. And then by the time that Ben came to me about making this a movie, I'd had a lot of my own time to heal and grow a little bit in that. It didn't feel like such an open wound. It felt like something I could share and talk about with other people. And it became very much about, I don't know, I feel like because automatically I'm talking to my director, it becomes much more of a clear story I had to tell. And instead of getting, sometimes you can get really myopic and muddled if it's just you staring at a page.
So he helped you open it up and you like that partnership.
Oh yeah,
that's
yeah,
awesome.
It was incredible.
And how long did it take from play to movie? Writing the script?
That's a good question. I mean, the first draft came pretty quickly, but it was a really fat, you know, unmanageable first draft, like an obese first draft. But I've always believed that getting the first draft out of the way and just getting it written so that you can rewrite is the most important thing. So I'll say it took maybe 6 weeks to write it, but in terms of getting to where the movie, even to the shooting script, I'd say it took about a year and a half.
Wow, okay, got it. So the movie gets made, and how long after you guys had locked picture did it get distributed?
We got distribution at Sundance, so Fox Searchlight picked it up at Sundance. Mm-hmm. So that was 2 years.
So 2 years after.
Yeah.
And then the movie comes out, and did you have any sense of what it was going to do in the marketplace?
No, I didn't even like think of words like marketplace. I really didn't. I mean, and also coming from the theater, and this was the first movie I'd ever dealt with in my life, I had felt like the performances that we got while we were shooting, that was it. Like, I felt like I saw this incredible performance, you know, and it was so beautiful. And then I was like, oh, wait, they recorded this and more people are going to see it? And it didn't feel real. I mean, it really, I just didn't have a sense of it. And I'm really glad that I didn't have any expectation or hope or anything, because I was able to just move on really without any kind of emotion, because I didn't know to have any emotion. Which is great. Sometimes ignorance is awesome, like your best friend.
So the movie comes out and it obviously gets the reviews that it does, it wins the awards that it does. So what were some of the surprises that came out of that experience for you? Like, you just said, God, you know what, I just saw the movie as I thought it was a play, it was done, it's over, I'm moving on, and now, you know, it's coming back into your life with, you know, the attention that it received, the awards that it won, and so what was it for you that was, you know, surprising as far as that experience is concerned? Something that you hadn't thought about or just didn't even expect?
I think it was that it still felt so it felt so personal to me and also so strange. I mean, we went through the Sundance Lab with the script and then showing it to people, it was always like, this is a weird play, this is a weird movie. You know, like, I think there's something about writing your own story and the initial reaction being, this is weird, that makes you put up walls a little bit. Mm. And so I was so delighted. I was so delighted that people could relate to, I mean, everybody has a father, and so, you know, whatever that form takes in their lives, everybody has a relationship with their father. And so people would just, after screenings, people would come to Ben and talk to him about, you know, the brilliance of the cinematography, the brilliance of the direction. And they would come to me and just start telling me these stories about their fathers, like their relationship with their fathers. And it stopped being about craft and business altogether. And it just became these people telling me these very personal stories about being with their dad when he passed away, or these things they would do with their, or like missing their dad their whole lives and wondering, you know, I mean, just these incredible, very personal things. So I think it was, and like, to me, that's why we do this. Like, that's why we make things, is hoping that people will connect that their stories and see their stories in a new way.
That's awesome. So, obviously everyone here has come up to you. Most people have said how much they love the movie. It's one of the things that that resonated with me was just the uniqueness of the world. I knew nothing about this, right? And how were you able to? Because I mean, I know a little bit about your background and how you were able to attract it, but how did you go about capturing this really weird, off, you know, the map, literally kind of world and make it accessible to people? Was that something that you consciously went out and did, or was it something that you're just like, you know, I'm just going to write this based on what I see and know?
Yeah, no, it was actually very carefully constructed how we would bring people into the world. And one of the biggest, I mean, we were talking about this at lunch today, but it's always a challenge every project I do, because I tend to write about worlds that are not what you'd see on, you know, if you flip on CBS, it's not necessarily, I don't think that's what anyone's world looks like, but it's not what mine looks like. And so I think there's always this learning curve and just moment of trial and error where you just learn how to set up the world in a very structured way and then learn how to bring people into it. So, I mean, the first 10 minutes of the movie, that was a lot of trial and error, and just showing it to our advisors at the labs, and I don't understand it, coming back, reworking it, setting up the rules with each other.
Got it. And I know that and finding the lead for the movie was a process in and of itself. So tell us a little bit about that.
Ben and then Michael Gottwald, one of our producers, were very, God, I wish I could remember the number. I'm so bad at remembering. I want to say it's 2,000 girls or 3,000. I wish I could remember the number, and I don't want to get quoted on it. So it's a big number, but they looked at a lot of girls for this role. And and Quvenzhané came in, and it was immediate. I mean, it was an immediate, everybody knew. And she was 5 when she came in, and the character I was thinking was gonna be between 9 and 12. And so that was a little bit of an adjustment for me, but it was completely, I don't even wanna say it was worth it. It was not a question that this was her movie, and now this was the collaboration we were all going to do. And she's incredible. She's so sweet, so like joyful, had such a great time.
Personality,
yeah, she's just a really sweet girl. And I mean, she's gone on to so much success since then. She's incredible.
That's really, really cool. And obviously the relationship between the daughter and the father is such an important component of the movie. So did you cast her first and then the dad?
We did. Yeah, just because we weren't sure. We looked, it was very open casting call, so we didn't know necessarily what she looked like. In South Louisiana, people look very different. I mean, I don't even want to say ethnically it's different, because it's just everybody looks different. You know, there's a lot of diversity. I guess that's what I would say. And so we weren't sure.
With the mix and match, and you just looked to, and then, and just out of curiosity, how long did that process take to find the dad, and then I know that part of it was reworkshopping the script when the two of them were there.
Yeah, Dwight, we also knew right away. Dwight has a really interesting story. He owned a bakery in New Orleans and built it up himself, like worked at his other job to build the bakery piece by piece. And then when Katrina hit, he brought people in and wow. fed them. And he's just an incredible, incredible person, but he really has that determination and like, I'm gonna hold on to, you know, and drive that Wink has. But it was a lot of work to get him to leave his business for some time and come work with these crazy young people to like make this weird movie. So but he's just incredible. He had a very natural instinct for it. He's a father of five, and he's very warm and also a fighter, and he's just incredible. But yeah, so the role had to be that their dynamic really changed the entire movie because she was so much younger than we expected. And just what they brought to it, they brought this really nice playfulness and this joy and also this, I guess this real love. Like to me, you can see how much he loves her the whole
movie.
The whole movie, yeah.
That's great. So playwrights are thought of as, well, playwrights are treated as God in theater. You know, they basically, they're the ones, they're the last stop. That's where the buck mm-hmm. stops. Whereas screenwriters in the entertainment industry, not necessarily the case. So what would you say the function of a screenwriter is when it comes to an overall project, a movie?
I think I would say it's, you're all there. You're the screenwriter, the art director, the cinematographer, the director, the actors, you're all there to make one thing. And you are an important part of that process, but you're not the process. Like your words are, you have a job to do, and it's not necessarily about how great your words are. I mean, I'm only saying that because I see this. I see a lot of playwrights having trouble transitioning into screenwriting because there is that wanting to hold on to your words, and you're more, to me, it's a very exciting opportunity to collaborate and to do your very best to build this very strong foundation and a strong vessel for your actors and for your director to helm. But ultimately, if they need it changed or adjusted, you have to be able to make that adjustment. I mean, I feel like there's this flexibility with a
ownership?
With an ownership, yeah. That is good to have.
That's necessary for you to succeed. Got it. So the movie gets the awards that it does, the notoriety that it does. So how did that change your career as a writer?
I mean, it made my career as a writer because I didn't have one before. So there was that. I mean, I think it was, I was really fortunate to be able to, obviously it was really fortunate. We were all very fortunate to have it really accepted the way that it was. And I wanted to enjoy it, but also really go forward and not really, my dad's always been big on not resting on anything and not resting on your laurels or anything like that. And so it was important to me to just keep writing and keep. Also, if you pay attention to something you did that's already out and you can't control it anymore, I think it would just make me nervous. Like, you can't do anything. Like, there's nothing I can do now that would make a bad or a good review of the movie. You know what I mean? Like, I can't really change the course at this point, so.
So you just concentrate on moving forward and?
Yeah, I think the thing that you can, like, the only thing you can really control is how much work you put in every day. I mean, not even if it's good, not even what happens to it, but if you can do those hours or those pages, that's really all you can do, but there is this real fulfillment that comes from that.
That's awesome. So what? Tell us about your next project. What are you working on right now?
I just turned in. I might have to go back for rewrites, but I just finished The Secret Garden for Guillermo del Toro and Mark Johnson, which I'm really excited about. And I had an incredible time working with them. And I'm about to take a play to the Sundance Lab, which is about my dad again. I had dinner with his pretty well-known.
Noticing a theme here.
I know. I had dinner with this actress, and she was like, "So is all you write about your dad?" No.
And you're like, "Well."
The next one is about dinosaurs again. I'm gonna bring it all back. No, it's funny. I mean, I wish I could control a little more. I think some writers can say, I want this play to be about space and science, and I can't do that. I would love to be able to write a play about space. You know, I would love to be able to control what it is, but I don't work like that.
You're not wired that way.
I don't work that way.
So, and so the play is about your dad and you obviously the Secret Garden. What was it like to, what would you learn out of working with Guillermo del Toro and Mark Johnson? Obviously amazing filmmakers, have been around for quite some time. And,
yeah.
You know, and it's obviously a great property. What was it, what were some of the takeaways that you've been able to glean from the experience so far?
Well, I was really, with both of them, I was so struck by, Mark Johnson does, he's been working for, I want to say 30 years. It might be 20 and he'd get mad at me.
30 years.
I mean, so he did Rain Man, and he would tell me, he'd be driving me around and be like, "Oh yeah, when I was doing this with Rain Man," I was like, "Oh my God." and then he did Breaking Bad. So I spent so much of my time just trying not to geek out when I was in there and be like, "Can you show me the last season? Can you just tell me what happens?" No, but I was really struck by, with them, they've had so much, they've done so much good work and received so much success for good work, and they still do this. I mean, Mark works till like 8:30 at night. He's in the office early in the morning. Guillermo is similar, just working all the time. And there was this, I took a lot of comfort in that, because to me, they, like, that's a life that I can feel myself comfortable in, mm-hmm. is just going back to the pages every day, doing the work every day. It always makes me feel good to see that kind of work ethic
and commitment. Yeah, especially knowing that Mark, both of them have such huge careers, and people could just basically at that point take their foot off the pedal and just coast.
Yeah, they could totally coast.
But they're not. Yeah. No, that's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
So, tell us a little bit about your process as a writer, and you talked about obviously your dad being an inspiration, and you know, and choosing to work on The Secret Garden. So, how is it that you start a story? What's your process like?
I every morning I'll do like 3 to 5 pages of just free writing. And I've been doing that for probably since I was 9, a really long time. Not that long.
45 years ago.
Generally, at some point, it's almost like, I mean, I've never been to therapy, but I imagine it's sort of when Freudian therapy, I'm sort of making this up, but the kind of therapy where you just talk and then they land on something and they're like, "Let's talk about that. Let's talk about your mom." I think for me, if you just keep writing out whatever's in your mind, or at least for me, eventually I'll notice I keep coming back to things, or I'll keep writing about this phrase that I heard, and then they tend to grow out of that.
Got it. So, you know, I think that writers require a lot of time by themselves, typically, and they're incredibly reflective and introverted, right? How has that affected your personal life, or the desire to be in relationships or friendships? You know, how do you keep the sanctity of your process and still be able to function in the world?
Yeah, no, that's a really good question. I think because I've been doing it for so long, it never feels like a sacrifice. Like I love those hours that I get to write, and if I don't have that in the morning, I mean, when I was in LA, I would get up, the day would start at 5, and so I'd get up at 3 just so I could, do my pages and do that, because otherwise I don't feel right. I know a lot of artists, I know a lot of writers, most of them are in very good relationships, be they married or in a romantic partnership, or just most of them are pretty well functioning socially. I don't think
surprise.
No, but I think there is this myth of artists being like crazy and on heroin and like horrible at relationships, and only some of them. And I can tell you their names. No, I'm just kidding.
Once the mics go off.
Yeah. Yeah, it's never really been a problem for me. I mean, I really enjoy that time to myself, and I'm a pretty happy extroverted person, so I don't. It doesn't really. I don't feel like it's a
or a sacrifice, as you said.
Yeah, I don't feel like it's a sacrifice or a trade-off.
Got it. So obviously there are writers in the room.
Yeah.
There are directors, there are actors in the room. What sort of advice would you give them about their process and the you know just getting their work out in the world?
I mean, I'll just say what works for me is that even if what I'm writing that day is not good, and I know it's not good, I know none of this is going to end up in the final project, there's something about just having that routine and doing it and getting those pages out that you can still feel proud or take pride in that work, like that. Just that you did that, and just know that eventually something will grow out of that. I'm even hesitant to say that something will grow out of that. There's just something that you can take pride in about doing that work every day, the way that you would if you worked in a shop or owned a bakery or something like that.
That the whole process is success within itself.
Yeah, exactly. Like that success comes from just getting in and doing the pages. Or if you're setting hours, doing the hour. I mean, people set different quotas for themselves. But that, to me, is success.
Awesome. Yeah. Great. So let's open it up to questions.
Yeah.
Okay. Who would like to?
No, when I have a project that I'm full in on, I'll write, that's a good question, I'll do the free writing right away in the morning, and then whatever form I want that to take. It's gotten to where I know pretty quickly I want this to be the play, I want this to be the book, and then I'll work on that for however long I can.
Anyone else? Yes.
How did you find your producers, or did they find you?
They all went to Wesleyan with Ben Zeitlin, and they had all been friends a lot of them had been friends since high school. So we all ended up knowing each other from way back. Oh, but I'm sorry, for Secret Garden, my agent introduced me to Mark, who's incredible.
Very amazing. Guy. Who else?
A lot of narration. Mm-hmm.
Oh, that was planned. That was very like a hot topic at all the seconds. I'm sure any writer or director, I mean, using voiceover in movies is so tempting to do, and so few do it well and successfully. And then we can all think of Goodfellas or things like that, but it's, I love narration in movies personally. I know a lot of people don't, but that was always there. Because I think of it as storytelling. Like, I think of that movie as a
being
story.
Being told a story, like someone's telling a story.
Yeah.
Cool.
But people will yell at you for it if you submit a script. just get ready for it.
They will. As an executive, I was like, you're cheating.
Yeah,
you're cheating.
They do. They'll always.
Yeah, you're cheating. Braden?
Yeah, I mean, I lived in a very rural area, and so a lot of it was just out of necessity. I mean, the closest town was an hour away, and then the town where I went to high school, this really great public high school, was an hour and a half away. So that was a pretty long commute every day. But I was really fortunate to have a really good public library, and then when I was in high school, in that playwriting contest I entered, I ended up meeting a professor of playwriting at Florida State University, which was an hour and a half away from me, who, and what I really appreciated about that, it was the first mentorship I'd ever dealt with, but it wasn't like this soft, like, he didn't give me any compliments at all. He was like, there's too much exposition in this. And I didn't know to me, an exposition is a farm show. And so he was like, there's exposition in this. And I was like, no, sir, there's no livestock in my show. It was very like, he read the wrong play and he's accusing me of things. But he was very strict with me, which I really appreciated, and very much like, if you work really hard, you can turn this into something decent. You can tell the story that you want to tell if you work harder. And I've always responded to that kind of encouragement, as opposed to just like petting me and telling me that I'm smart, because I don't know that that helps anybody.
That's right. Yes.
What did you get most out of your Sundance writing workshop?
Oh wow! Yeah, I mean, that lab is incredible, and I can't recommend it. And I mean, it 100% changed my life, my career. I mean, they're incredible. I think it was when we were all. It made me reframe the whole process of storytelling, because they made us all go around and talk about the origin of the story rather than what's your script about, what's your pitch, can you fit your pitch onto a note card. It was, why are you telling this story as a film? Why does this have to be your story? Like, what is it really about? And it just taught me to distill intention in this really powerful way. I mean, even when I say it, that sounds very intellectual, but I really got it for the first time.
Wow. So what was that? What came up
with
that?
Beast, it was about, I mean, it was this huge sprawling script with all this magic and all this wild stuff in it. And we were still able to keep that, but ultimately it's about a girl losing her dad and the dad losing his daughter. And losing his world, and how he's gonna help her prepare to survive. And I mean, obviously that was kind of hard for me to land on, and there were things I would do to avoid it, but I also just had to clear through we had to clear through a lot of brush to really see it.
That's awesome. Anyone else? Yes.
What is the most challenging to you as a writer when you're writing?
I'm encountering it right now, I think, which is coming off of Secret Garden I worked on for about, I want to say a year, a little bit less than a year, but it was getting to the point where it was these very technical polishes and just making every line better, you know, just these really, the really fun kind of polishing, pleasurable stuff. And then to turn that in and to start on a first draft again, I had to remind myself that they suck at first. Like, I was like, how come I suck all of a sudden? Like, this isn't supposed to happen, but there's that thing about, and I realized it's because it had been about a year since I wrote a first draft, and they have to be really, you have to just get it out there, and they're gonna be really imperfect and broad at first. So I think it's that, I think it was just remembering that. When I'm writing, do you mean just like free? Sorry, I feel like I'm scratching. Oh, I know what it is. I'm sorry, guys. It's my necklace. Oh, y'all, I've ruined the panel. I don't.
I don't think you do, based on your process you shared with me. You just.
Yeah, I mean, only that I do it. Only that if it's not doing it is not an option. Which is better for me anyway, because I like to talk a lot, so I have to just get it out.
Yes.
We were mostly living in Pointe-Aux-Chenes, and so near where we shot, but we would we'd go back and forth from New Orleans. I love it. Greatest city in the world.
Oh, that's awesome.
Greatest.
Yes, Eric.
To me, I mean, I experience that too. I have to just make it about writing the pages and making the work, because there's a time to be self-critical after you've written the first draft, and then you can, or maybe even after the second draft is when you can really pull out the iron, you know, those like Russian torture devices that you can be like, what are you doing? But I always tell myself that there's a time for that, and it's not, it doesn't help to be that critical right away for me.
Brian.
I think writer's block, I'd be interested in what others have to say about this, but to me, it's more, writer's block is about that self-criticism. It's not that you're not thinking of anything, it's that you have something and you judge it right away as not being acceptable. So I just make myself do the pages, even if it's terrible.
Was there someone I thought to know? Okay.
There is an actual like factual number answer to that question, and I don't know it. I think it was a little longer than most indie movie shoots, but I don't know. I don't really. I wish I could remember that. I'm sorry. I think it's Googleable, but I don't remember. I have a really bad memory with numbers.
Numbers, right? Yes.
Yeah, I write with a pen and paper in the mornings, and then it just depends. If I love writing on pen and paper, it gets to where I do know very quickly what it wants to be, and so in the afternoons or just after I do those couple of pages, I'll just jump onto the computer. But I love just taking a notebook and writing it. I mean, that'll never get old for me.
That's cool.
Until my wrists fall off.
Last question, yes. Yep, you.
I generally, once I start knowing what the story wants to be, I know the ending first, and then I like to work backwards. And sometimes after I've done that, then the ending will change again. But I like to start with where we end and then go back.
Cool. Oh. I guess we have two more questions.
You know, that I don't know because I wasn't a part of, I would get to see clips of them after they had auditioned them and then called them back and selected them down. So I don't actually know the answer to that. I feel like Dwight was our, I know we were, I feel like he was such a strong choice for us that I, but I truthfully don't know.
Cool. Last question over there.
And you guys can come, like, I'm available, so, like,
yes.
I'm around. I'm really
I just want to be present at time and that we have another speaker coming up, so I want to give people a quick break. Yeah.
Oh, I think that's sort of more in the writer's block. I mean, I try not to, I can have someone tell me pretty quickly if something reads false, the producers I work with. And then when I reread it, I can generally tell if I'm trying to sound smarter than I am or if I'm trying to do something really deep or like artful, which is the worst thing. whenever I'm trying to impress somebody, it always ends badly. And but so usually when I'm rereading it, cool. And then I can just laugh it off.
All right. Lucy, thank you so much.
Thank you guys. I'm grounded. Thank you guys.